Hi, this is Linda Krogan. This is Search for Truth, and we're on lesson eight. So let me share the screen so that you can see this information and make it bigger. There we go. Okay, so today we're going to talk about the gifts of the Spirit. Now, a lot of people say, are they really important? Well, about as important as being baptized in Jesus' name and being filled with the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongues. Now, there are people that won't agree with me, but I don't see anything in the Word of God that's an option. It seems to me that when I read the book of Acts, even when I read the Gospels about the things that Jesus did, he operated in the gifts. The Old Testament prophets operated in the gifts of the Spirit. Now, the Spirit did not reside on them. It would come and go, but they operated in the gifts. And it wasn't really for the common man in the Old Testament, but in the New Testament, Jesus says that there are no big I's and little U's. He gave these when he gave the Holy Ghost to the disciples and to the apostles and to any believer. Read Mark 16. They are able to do everything. So you, if you are born again, which means that you are in covenant with Jesus Christ, you can't do anything without the covenant. But if you are in covenant with Jesus Christ, if you have taken on his name in water baptism and his spirit resides in you, which is the spirit of resurrection, and you know that because you spoke in tongues, that is the sign that God has ordained that you have received the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm talking about the book of Acts. I'm not talking about 1 Corinthians 11. I'm sorry, 12, the gift of divers kinds of tongues. That is something that the Spirit uses in the corporate body. There are two different operations of the same Spirit in the believer that is Spirit-filled. Okay, so the gifts of the Spirit, let's talk a little bit about this. There are different spirit gifts, sorry, well, different gifts, but the same Spirit. Okay, so when you receive the Holy Ghost, you have the spirit of all nine gifts. The first one is word of wisdom. Let's go to word of knowledge first because these work in tandem and often overlap. So word of knowledge is that the Spirit of God gives you knowledge or information. You can use the word information. About something that is in someone's past or their present. Word of knowledge is not about the future. That's a different gift. Once you have received this word of knowledge, then you need the word of wisdom to know what to do with it. Okay, so these work together. There also is a word of wisdom in that when someone wants a healing or they want a prayer answered, that the Lord may give that other person that is ministering to them, whether it be ministry or layman, a word that would activate that miracle, that would activate that promise, that would activate that gift in that person's life. And that also would be word of wisdom. Okay, so word of knowledge, God wants to do this in your life. Word of wisdom, this is what you need to do, receive it. Sometimes it's as simple as just literally taking a step forward on the floor with your feet. That is a sign of your faith that you believe. Sometimes as simple as that. Sometimes it is a word of wisdom that you need to go make restitution. You know, there's a lot of different things that God would like you to do very simple things that you can do, that you can accomplish in order for the path of that miracle or that answer to be opened. Okay, so the gift of faith, that is an extra dose of faith. Every man is given a measure of faith when they come into the kingdom. But the gift of faith is kind of like you're borrowing God's faith about a certain situation. Okay. Now it can be manifested in many ways. When I am praying for someone to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, the Lord usually gives me a download of faith that they will indeed get it, and that there are certain things I need to do. So yeah, gift of faith, gift of knowledge, and gift of wisdom all put together in one whole, and it operates so that person can actually receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That's just one way. There's other ways that the gift of faith operates. It's God's faith in a certain situation. So you can see the diversity of situations that this could be manifested. Okay. Healing. Healing is the gift of healing is usually defined as a process, as opposed to miracles. Miracles are instantaneous, and they don't necessarily mean restoration of a physical restoration, as in an illness. It can mean that, but it could mean a lot of other things. So miracles isn't just for instantaneous healing, although it does encompass that. Healing, the gift of healing, is like a process starts, and over the time of a certain period, that person will get better and better and better and better in regards to healing. And for instance, we prayed for a lady who had stage 4 liver cancer, and the Lord gave her a new liver. And over the process of about a month, she got better and better and better as that new liver cleansed out her system of all of those intense toxins. So it took a while for the liver to catch up and then go beyond, but it was a brand new liver, so it could do that. Okay. Miracles, they could be recreative miracles. I don't know if you've ever heard of somebody who there's something wrong with her hip, so that one leg is shorter than the other, and they're prayed for, and their leg actually grows. So that is like a recreative or miracle that it wasn't that way before, but now it is. Okay. Prophecy. Now we come to word of knowledge of the future. So we have prophecy. Something's going to happen in their future. And the person who is operating the gift can tell them, maybe not always exact specifics. You know, God is not out to embarrass people, but he definitely is out to raise faith and encourage his people. And this could happen in any kind of situation, but it is definitely about the future. Discerning of spirits. Have you ever walked into a room and you felt like, ooh, this is a tough crowd? Okay, well, that's kind of discerning of spirits because you haven't even met anybody yet. Or if you walked into a place like this is not discerning of spirits, but when we went to one time we went to Disney World in Los Angeles, and you just walk on the grounds and there's like a happy that's everybody's smiling, and you think, oh, okay, this is a nice place. Okay, well, sometimes I've walked into a room and I could feel that my Holy Ghost was accepted in that place. Then that would be discerning of spirits. And that's before I even talk to anybody. Okay, interpretation of tongues. Well, let's start with tongues. I'm not sure why they put it that way, but who made this PowerPoint, but Tongues has to come first. Now, there's diverse kinds of tongues. So it's a tongue that is different than what you would use in your own personal prayer life. It comes forth in a different sound, in a different language, if I could use that. And then it is also interpreted. Now, because the tongues by itself does nothing in the corporate body. These tongues interpretation is used corporately. And like in a church service, the tongues is kind of like a backup beeper. Boop, 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 boop. Something's coming. And the interpretation then is God speaking to his people. Now you can have interpretation of tongues without the tongues, but that's called prophecy. That's when someone stands up and just speaks forth in the language that everybody understands, okay? Be it whatever place, country or nation or whatever, okay, or language. Okay, so that's an overview of all the gifts of the Spirit. Now, can you have all nine? Yeah, you can. But, the gifts of the Spirit are dependent. After you receive the Holy Ghost, you're dependent on two things. First of all, your relationship with the Lord, because it is driven by the Spirit. And the second one is your level of compassion for people, because the gifts are driven by compassion. Read about Jesus. He did so many things because he had compassion on them, like sheep that were lost with no shepherd, that are scattered. These are the things that drive a person in this that has the Spirit of God to go ahead and seek after the gifts because they have compassion for the people. Okay. All right. So there are works of the flesh and there are fruits of the Spirit. Okay. So the works of the flesh, we all know those. We lived in them before we came to God. If we had continued to live for them in those gifts of the flesh, we would have ended up in the lake of fire because hell will be dumped into the lake of fire. My husband says that hell is like the county jail, but the lake of fire is penitentiary, much worse. However, we're going to keep our heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. So there's love, joy, long suffering, which is great patience, faith, gentleness, peace, goodness, meekness, and temperance. Okay, so these are out of Galatians 5, 22 and 23. These are the fruits of the Spirit, of a Holy Ghost filled believer. Okay, so these are the things we strive for. Why do we care? Why do we care? Because the works of the flesh separate from us from God. The fruits of the Spirit endear us and draw us closer to God. And like I said before, with the gifts of the Spirit, you can't operate in the Spirit unless you have compassion and that you have a close walk with God. That's what matters, our relationship with God, but it also matters our relationship with man to man. If you look at the Ten Commandments, the first, I believe, four have to do with our relationship with God, and the rest of the other six have to do with our relationship with man. So there's three parts to the law. One is the sacrificial law, which clears all our lives to be able to connect with God. There's the moral law, and that is how we treat other people. The sacrificial law was satisfied by Jesus Christ, so we don't have to do the animal sacrifice anymore. We just need to go to God. But the moral law, that's how I treat my brother, how I treat other people, how I treat my neighbor, whether they're brothers in the Lord or they're sinners in the world, it doesn't matter. I need to treat them with these gifts of fruits of the Spirit. And then the third part of the law is the dietary law, which teaches us how to take care of our own bodies. So you have how to draw closer to God, how to draw closer to our fellow man, and have a healthy relationship in both situations, and then have a healthy relationship with our own body. Okay. So those are the things that the fruits of the Spirit take care of. Make sure that our relationship with God is not hindered because of our relationship man to man. Okay. Okay, there it goes. Okay. All right. Let's talk about separation from the world. It is a trend in this day and age to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal savior, and you start reading and praying and start living the best you can, but you have not really separated from the world. You still look like the world. Maybe you talk a little bit better, but you probably go a lot of the same places. But you still look like the world. And to have a relationship with God, we have to put off the works of the flesh. We have to separate ourselves. We have to be careful how we dress, what we look like, how we talk. And there are scriptures in the Word of God that dictate that. Okay, so you got to guard your tongue, be holy in all manner of conversation. So you have to be careful what you say and how you say it. You have to be careful that you don't offend. Now, some people are just walking a fence, but let's not add to that. Okay. Guard your hand, be separate and touch not the unclean thing. What are unclean things in this day and age? Well, going to bars, being seen in places that you ought not to be, touching things that you ought not to touch, specifically people of the opposite sex. Okay. Guard your eyes. I was setting a wicked thing before mine eyes. That has to do with videos and magazines and even listening to inappropriate things. Your relationship with Jesus Christ is more important than anything else. And so to keep your hands, your tongue, and your eyes holy helps you have a relationship with the Lord. And that's where all the fun is. That's where the power of God resides, is in our relationship. Watch your appearance, women adorn themselves in modest apparel. I've been to some churches that I think, dear me, are you here fishing for a man? Because you sure look like it. I mean, their face is all made up like a whore, really. It's just, I don't take the definition of beauty of the world and bring it in the church and keep that definition. No, God wants us to have a different definition. We want to perfect holiness in the fear of God, loving God, worshiping God, understanding He's the King of the universe. Holiness, the end everlasting is the holy, the end of holiness is everlasting life. Blah, blah. You present your bodies holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Well, that means that I have to look different than everybody. Well, you are different from everybody. You're a new creature. You have the Holy Ghost. You've been baptized. When my husband and I were dating, he used to wear this musk, and I couldn't breathe. I still can't. Musk stops me, gets into my lungs, and is like, I can't breathe because it's I don't know something about it. And I told him about it, and he quit wearing it, and he hasn't worn it since. There were some colors and some clothing that each one of us has had from before, and maybe he didn't like those colors on me, and maybe I didn't like those patterns on him. I mean, you give and take, but how much more do you need to do that if you are serving the Lord God of the universe? There are things he just does not like, and one of them is displaying your body. Even pants on women, no. You don't display those kinds of body parts, the outlinings of your body. I don't care if everybody's doing it. You're not everybody. You're bought with a price. You're not your own. And it is up to you to seek ways to please your heavenly Father and that bridegroom that you're going to spend eternity with. That's what we're here for. And that's the long and short of it. If you please him, if you come before him and you have sacrificed the things of this world to draw closer to him, will you not then be able to be involved in his movings in this earth, in his touching of people's lives and conversion of souls and operating in the spirit? Yeah, that's all the positive stuff that you get to do. It talk to him and he talks to you. These are the pros on the other side of the equation. Yeah, you look different, you talk different, you seem different. Not everybody likes that. Well, who cares? Who cares what they like and what they don't like? I only care what he likes and what he doesn't like. That's all I care about. If you're not of that mindset, you're in the wrong camp. Okay. So Paul then he persecuted the church, and he was struck down. His big come to Jesus conversion was in Acts chapter 9. Okay. He was stoned, he was beaten. He did accomplish three missionary journeys. He wrote 14 epistles in the New Testament. And finally, he was beheaded, which is a very Roman execution, because he was Roman. He did have Roman citizenship. He was all Jew. He was all Jew. But he did somehow, his father had acquired Roman citizenship, which is very uncommon for a Jew. He did all these things. In Acts chapter 9, he's called Saul. So why was his name changed to Paul? Because Saul, with an S, is the Jewish version, and Paul is the Gentile or Greek version. So we know him as Paul because he had quite a huge ministry to Gentiles. And that's why we read, a lot of times we read his books, like the book of Romans that he wrote to the Roman Christian Jews and Gentiles in the Roman Church. A lot of people take that as the salvation book. No, it's not. The church started in Acts. Anybody will tell you that. And if they don't tell you that, don't go to that church anymore because they're lying. They're not telling you the truth. But the book of Romans was written to converted Christians. And within the Christian church, you had Christians who were Gentiles, and then you have people of the way, which were Jewish, and they both went to the same church, and that was tricky. So Paul dealt with that a lot. And if you want to know a little bit more about that, look at Romans, Galatians, Hebrews, Those three books specifically deal with this contention between the Jewish Christians, or what they are called in Jewish circles, people of the way, and the Gentile Christians. Okay. Persecution spread in Jerusalem, but that is not to say there were thousands and thousands of converted Jews in Jerusalem. Many, many of the priesthood converted. You can find that in the Bible. They went to Samaria. Peter, on the day of Pentecost, Peter said, you know, this is of God, and you need to do it. So he preached to the Jews. Then Philip, who's actually a deacon, went and preached in Samaria, which is the place where you have half Jews, half Gentiles. They are a mixed group. And that goes back to the Assyrian captivity of the 10 tribes in the Old Testament. And when they returned, they were mixed, half Jew, half Gentile. But Philip went there, and Peter had to come and lay hands on them so they could receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. So that was door number two. Then he was taken to Caesarea, where he came before kings, which was prophesied of Paul before he became a Christian. Antioch is where they first were called Christians. That must have been because they were mainly Gentiles there, but there were also Christian, sorry, Jews there who were converted, and they. Paul attended that church. That was his main church, and they in Antioch there were a lot of Jews that Paul had killed their wives, their fathers, their mothers, their children, their husbands, their family members, and yet they embraced him at his conversion, and he stayed there a long time. And then they went to the uttermost parts of the earth. There's stories of apostles going a lot of places. Thomas was supposed to have been murdered way far in the east, in Iran and Iraq. They went to China. They went to India. They went all kinds of. They went to Spain. They went to Alexandria. They went everywhere. If not the apostles, then their believers, their disciples. And in Rome, believers met severe persecution. Matter of fact, there was a point where the Caesar ordered all Jews out of Rome. And that's why Aquila and Priscilla went traveling and met Paul. And they also met Apollos. So a lot of Christians were murdered by lions, by bulls. It's just unbelievable, unbelievable, unbelievable. But you know what? The church grew. It was amazing. The church grew. So the Lord had told them that the temple was going to be destroyed. This was mainly because they had rejected Jesus Christ as a nation. So the destruction came in 70 AD. And it was Caesar Titus that led. The Romans were just sick of the Jews' rebellion. They're just sick of it. And just, okay, that's it. We're just destroying everything. And everything in the temple they took, and there was gold, there was all kinds of things there, and they just took it all. Now, understanding that after they came back from Babylon, there was no Ark of the Covenant, there was no menorah, there was no altar of incense, there was no table of showbread that were the original four pieces of furniture from the tabernacle of Moses. Those were hid away. And I believe that the Jews know where they are, but they won't take them out into the open because they know that it'll start war. So the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple, they were led away captive into all nations until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Okay, so we're looking for that time because at when the time of the Gentiles is fulfilled, the Gentile church specifically, and we're going to talk about that, when that day comes, there will be a rapture, and then God will turn his attention exclusively toward the Jews, and he will bring them to a point of acknowledging him as the reigning Messiah, and then he will fold this all up and will be done, and will the church will already be home. Okay, so after that, okay, so this was in 70 AD. Peter was murdered, crucified, he and his wife, probably in Caesarea, because he spent his whole time basically in Jerusalem. And they would have taken him to a Roman stronghold, which would have been Caesarea, which was on the Mediterranean Sea, right next to Jerusalem. And they crucified him in, I think, the early 60s. Paul was crucified, I think, or I mean, beheaded later than that. And the last apostle, John, died somewhere in that last 10 years of the first century, so somewhere between 90 and 100 AD. Once they were all gone and Jerusalem had been destroyed, persecution continued for several more, couple more centuries. So you have Constantine, who's in the 300s. He apparently, it is said, embraced Christianity, but his version of Christianity was extremely influenced by Greeks. That's why we have a Trinity doctrine, because the Greeks would not accept that there was one God, first of all, because it was a Jewish belief and they hated Jews, but also because it fit more with their what's called a pantheon or multiple God view. So they changed baptism, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, so you could be baptized three times. Infant baptism and sprinkling came into being because it was used by rulers to keep track of the population, the infant population, so they knew when a child reached 18 that he could be pressed into the army. So it was very important that they had infant records. So using baptism, that worked, there was a great falling away, which is talked about. In other words, the gospel, as it was preached by the apostles, became distorted. It lived in different places, but it was horribly persecuted by the Catholic Church. And so we talk about the Dark Ages, not because it was literally dark, but because knowledge of the gospel became darkened. It's hard to find it. It was alive, but people who believed in those baptism were murdered by the Catholic Church. Those who believed in one God were murdered because of the Catholic Church. Those who believed in baptism in Jesus' name, or even adult baptism all by itself, they were murdered in horrifying ways. So it was hard to find someone who was willing to tell you the gospel. And there were pieces of it everywhere. There wasn't probably too many people that had the whole package, but it still survived. So the next thing we're going to talk about, this is a kind of like lesson eight supplement that we'll talk about the next time. And that'll be just pure church history. How did we get back to the original church? Oh, and are we back to the original church? Are we there? And if so, and if not, I mean, those are two questions we have to think about. If we're back and if we're not quite back, and how did we get to the full gospel understanding of new birth? So that's what we're going to talk about the next time. God bless you and take care. And we will see you, let's see, next time. And let's stop that. Okay, there you go. And God bless. Bye-bye.